philosophy we talked about yesterday.
Philosophy?
Philosophy.
Style, behavior.
Race. Put a little bit more words on
what?
Race.
Yeah.
That was a little bit of race yesterday.
Yeah.
What we were hoping to get from the actual conference itself, what our objectives were to not
expectations.
Principles.
Yeah. Sorry?
Principles.
Principles, yeah. Coaching principles. Yeah. Yeah. Was there anything new?
Way of teaching and learning, and we got into a bit more specifics on group management and that sort of stuff.
Yeah. Anything new for you guys yesterday? Or
I didn't know about short-time tutors.
Some short-time tutor. You didn't know what that was. Okay, so that's a short-time person. Yeah. Yeah.
I'm just wondering where the town significant vendor was to Australia. Financial support and lack of there is,
yeah.
And how we can improve it. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good. I don't know how you guys are kind of dealing with information like you got yesterday, and it's going to be even more today, tomorrow, and Monday. Normally, I'm reflecting a lot, trying to reflect, and the best time for me as a person is when I am lying in bed, trying to recap today, so what's actually going on, try to play the film of today, and then try to capture some of the things. So what did I actually get out of this day today?
Can I play audio of it?
You can do that. I don't mind. He's apparently awake in the night and listening to me snoring, so that's okay. I know that you will all have some different kind of ways of trying to capture some of the things that you were being that we talked about yesterday. But again, I think it's a good way of trying to save things on the hard disk, especially when you get so intense conference as you have here, different kind of information, a lot of information flows just going towards you. So yeah, it's a good idea. What we also did yesterday was just having a look at your invitations. So before, again, TJ, just have a couple of comments on
Yesterday is some really good news, really, because we summarized kind of all the expectations that you have, and I think we've covered it all yesterday. kind of split it up in three, kind of six areas, and there was one person that had one specific comment which we know is going to be covered up by Ian. The run video analysis is going to be quite a specific topic on that, so that's great. Of course, when you come to conferences, always you always want to learn something new and new ideas and sharing things. So obviously that's come out as the main expectation. The good thing is that will hopefully kind of automatically happen as we share and talk about things. But that filters through then, of course, also in new ways or strategies to teach technical and technical and gain new knowledge in those areas, which obviously we'll spend a lot of time on course, so we're kind of pretty hopeful that we'll cover that off. But don't expect the magic bullet either. So we'll try and we'll discuss this more of a bit of an idea of how we can kind of make sure that we can share new ideas across the board and looking at different ways of teaching. Yeah, so we'll definitely do that. It's also a lot about pathways and player development and the bigger picture. We had kind of a reasonable discussion yesterday already about some of the stuff, but there's also sort of the Better Australia element coming quite clearly through in the education. And I know that Marianne has covered some of that, but we've made some notes and probably feed it back to Marianne about perhaps where there's opportunities to have another session or some talk here, or whether you follow up with you guys afterwards around that. And coaching practices, which we talked about a little bit yesterday, but also it was good to see that people talk about coach relationships and how to strengthen that. And one way is to be here, but also when you go back, you will work with other coaches and how to kind of strengthen that. So that's kind of like the main thing. Obviously, there's some obviously routines as well, some on-court, some off-court, which we'll cover when we go on-court. So that's basically a summary from what you guys have written down. So if at any stage there's anything new that you actually say, oh, actually, we wouldn't mind having some of that, whether you join it in a group or whether you approach us afterwards or in between session, feel free. Sometimes the most valuable conversations happen over a 12-piece rib steak. and that's one of the reasons why we go on a 12, because then we have more time to chew through it. So feel free to kind of do it, because those, when you're in a conference, that's often when you have the opportunity in between over lunch in the evening, and then you have this conversation about Benton and Dell and all this exchanging experiences. Sometimes you just don't have the time to do it because you're on topic and you're talking about specific things. So I don't know where we're going tonight, maybe someone else, but all right, cool. Thank you. Any questions on that, sorry?
Okay. Just comment on that. We also, TJ and I talked about great first day yesterday. It was awesome actually to being in a conference like this with 12, 13, 15 people and actually on day one get a lot of feedback, a lot of conversation around the table, just keep that up. It's like, yes, we're here to share ideas and here to, I'm here to learn something as well. Hopefully some of you can bring something on to me and that's gonna be awesome. So just keep it up and be interested and curious and ask the questions when there's something that you either don't understand or something that you want to share with the rest of us. So planning for performance is the topic to start out with this morning. How many of you guys or who is actually using planning in your coaching today? And when I'm talking planning, it's like sitting, reading, writing down things. Planning is of course a lot of things. Planning could be up here, okay, I have to plan my next session, but planning could also be and who is working with, so a couple of questions here. So who's actually putting something on paper and who is working with individually players where you make, like say, annual planning, who's doing that? Any kind of planning?
Only the first part.
Only the first part, kind of group planning.
Group planning.
Yeah.
Program.
Yeah. Anyone who work with one-on-one individuals where you make annual plans and stuff like that?
Not annual plans, but longer term.
So what's a long-term plan when you say that? What's how long is that?
Well, I do coach one-on-one, but then these are like intermediate players. When you first get to know them, I'd like to see where their expectations are, just like when we get together. Some of them may not want to be with badminton for a long time, but they were told they're pretty good with their clubs.
Yeah.
And then their coaches could say, maybe it's worthwhile for you to go and find someone who can just teach you, coach you, rather than be with all of us, because you aren't going to get much out of this now. So they come to me.
Yeah.
And you sit down with them. I do like it to have a longer plan, rather than, all right, just another person coming in.
Yeah.
And usually, I like to see where they are, their skill set are, and maybe asking them what do they want. And most of the time, I only have three anyway.
Yeah.
Most of the time, they would have already known. So one of them has very unreal goals. Like, how many tournaments did you win? Are you like as good as Lin Dan or whoever? I said, no, I'm not at all. My golf trophies. A number of my golf trophies are more than my tournament trophies from badminton. So if you want someone else, you can go somewhere else.
But
so
you need
the expectations and then match against what they have.
Yeah.
And then we make a plan. Usually it's like a monthly plan up till the middle of the year. And then again, we measure against those by either if they want to test themselves out on tournaments or just challenge another player or what have you. But that's pretty much what I do.
Why would we plan? Why do we make any plans?
Because you will fail on the plan.
It's something to measure.
There you go.
And measure your progress in relation to what you're seeking to achieve for them and also what they're seeking to achieve.
Yeah.
For the end. And then you can review that and then you can build on that plan and adjust it or change it whichever way.
Yeah.
I think it also sets things into motion. Without an objective, without a plan, if you don't go there, doesn't mean, like, from what I see in high performance, just about nobody sticks to the original plan. It's always going around and finding a way, but without that there, you'll be there going, oh, I wonder what I have to do. So it gets you into motion.
It's like a former prime minister suggesting that our plans are aspirational.
Yeah.
The plan gives you small steps, you know, to reach your end goal.
Yeah. So we can all agree that planning is something
that's necessary.
It's necessary in one way or the other. Because so it's a good thing that we have it on the topic this morning, right?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
And it's a good thing you're there.
So yeah, planning could be quoted like failing to plan is planning to fail. I don't know if that's 100% true, but I like the idea of that, sorry.
I was going to say, having a plan really is saying, let's make practical our aspiration. And so what you do is you put the aspiration up there, and that's in mind. So once it's in mind, then a lot of other things happen apart from setting the goals and working backwards. So here's a vision for you, here's where we're going, and then people can get on board with attitude and motivation.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. Yeah. And one way of looking at plans or kind of that kind is looking a little bit more into the coaching part of, in this case, the coaching process. This is taken from BWF. So
can I just ask how much of this can we actually just take photos of someone on the sound, but is this going to be a problem if I take into the
show? Yeah, share that in. We can share the presentations.
Do not copy.
But again, Ian is coming later today, and we can just have a chat with him and ask him how much is actually you want. TJ asked Ian about it, and he said, yes, of course. And I think also, as Marianne was told yesterday, Ian will be here also trying to sell BWF. So I think he's keen, but this is not BWF.
So that is not.
This is BWF. Oh,
okay.
But this conference is not BWF.
Okay.
So, but yeah, this process here is the way that BWF looking at it: plan, deliver, review, evaluate, and that's kind of a circle that just goes over and over again in the whole process of actually, no matter where we are. In the whole, either if it's a short-term training session, long-term, whatever, this is kind of the same plan that we could, or coaching process that we could use. So it could be, as I said, it could be just a general next training session tomorrow, 10 to 12, plan it, deliver it, review it, and evaluate it. And then again, bang, 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 and you have your short-term goals, or long-term goals, or mid-term goals, and so on. So this is just a way to planning covers a little bit more. And again, Peter mentioned a little bit safe facilities, player information in terms of getting the knowledge about the players, any medical issues. Phone numbers, if something happened, all these sort of stuff that you have to be aware of when you're coaching, making sure that you have all the player kind of registration. That's just my opinion in terms of getting information about the player, so if something happened, you know what's going on, especially now we're going to be probably stepping a little bit off in terms of are we coaching
intermediate or beginners, or now we start talking a little bit more about performance, because that's where I see planning being even more important. Of course, we need to have some kind of planning when we are also having beginners, but when we start talking individual plans and so on, it's got to start when we having players who really want to take it to the next level. I'm not sitting with totally new beginners in white hat or saying, okay, what's your individual plan? Now we're going to make a 12 months annual plan or an annual plan for you with each one of them. So it's something that when we get a certain level that we start doing using these plans. So the first couple of two here in safe facility plan is just getting all the information about what's going around, what's the environment that we are part of. And then we're getting more into the observe and analyze of the players or the whole squad, the group players, the goal setting and the session planning. So in other words, it could mean that planning is where are we now? Where is it that we want to go, and how can we actually get it there? That's nearly what planning is about. So try to get an idea of where are we, where do we want to get, and how do we go there.
Do you have any generic template you use for your players?
In terms of?
The plan? The whole plan, so you took up all the goals, and do you have a kind of set form that you, standard form that you use? Obviously you're capturing, you know, the overarching end, long-term goals, short-term, blah, blah, blah.
So in terms of, for example, an annual plan for individual players,
yeah,
I have some photocopies to hand out. Yeah. And again, this for BWF, everyone is different in terms of how they like to do it. And I'm trying in this case to keep it. I have my own way of doing it. I could actually show you, try to find it on my laptop later, and just show you an idea of how an action plan could look like. But I copied it from, and I'll hand it out in a bit, how it could look like. So again, taking from BWF, how they see it. So yeah, but when we're talking about this planning and where are we now, which area are we looking at?
It's a model asset that we've got. What have you got available?
So when we're talking about Vectron, of course, in terms of which performance factors can be influenced, which performance factors do we have in Vectron? To observe and analyze, yeah. So where are we in this? What are the five key performance factors that we're working with in Vectron? Anyone?
What are the rankings?
No. So
technical
is a performance factor, right? What more? Technical is where are we now? Technical, right? Where do we want to get to, technical? And how are we going to get there? So what are the four other?
Is fitness one of them?
Fitness, so yeah. Physical. So we have technical, physical.
Mindset,
so psychological. Yeah. Two more.
Tactical.
And the last one? So we have technical, tactical, physical, psychological. And what's the last one?
Intellectual.
What?
Not intellectual.
Not intellectual.
Facility.
What?
Facility. Think out of the
emotional environment.
Think out of the box here, guys. So what are we talking? We're talking players.
Parents.
We're talking
parents.
The lifestyle, right?
Yeah.
Parents. So lifestyle is one of them as well. So we need to take all these four key things into consideration when we're talking and trying to make a plan. Every five component is very, very important in terms of making that plan. So when we start looking at, and here's one of the templates, this is just
and I'm here again taking from BWF, to observe and analyze where are we now. That could be, and I think, you know, normally when we are looking at players in terms of trying to observe and analyze where are we at this moment with the players, we normally tend to go out and say, okay, we just look at the players in general and say, okay, this is, but we need to break it down to say, okay, I'm looking at this player in either in a training session, in a match situation, but then you have to break it down and say, okay, now I'm actually focusing on this footwork. So where are we now with the footwork from a technical perspective? Where are we? That could be in balance, it could be rack skills, tactical skills, it could be, but you need to break it down to actually go in and say, where are we at this moment with these technical, all these different kind of skills. And to be able to analyze it, yes, the better coaches we are, the better we are to actually observe and analyze either during normal routines, training situations, or in game play and stuff like that, but we could also put up exercises in our first kind of session plan and say, okay, we have a group session here. First time of the year, the first two or three sessions I'm gonna have, I'm gonna make some predictable exercises where I know I can see how is the racket skills on the front court or how's the footwork in these situations. So you can actually create the situations by having some predictable exercises put in place to go and say, okay, this is put in place to actually go in and analyze and observe where the other players are at the moment. What's the difference between observe and analyze? Or if you go back to the coaching cycle where we have review and evaluate, what's the difference?
Observations need to be what they do, and not making any judgments beyond that.
Yep.
It's only what you see, and then the analysis is what you can infer from your observations.
Yeah, correct. Very important, especially in your observation part of it, or in the review, that you are careful not writing, putting down what you're not seeing. As you said here, that we are normally, or we have the intention a lot of times to just go out and say, okay, he didn't do that, or he didn't do this, or that wasn't good, or, but actually when we're observing, trying to be good and just putting in what you can actually see. It could be, let's say, okay, we're talking grip situations, I'm focusing on grip now. 10 players in one squad, and then observing, okay, 3 out of 5, or 3 out of 10 is not using, 3 out of 10 is using a thumb grip. So you're not saying 7 out of 10 is not using thumb grip. It's not a, but again, be careful to put down what you're not seeing, but actually putting down what you're seeing. And then from that, make the analysis afterwards. Different kind, this is just one kind of thing. There's heaps of them, different ways, and you're more than welcome to come and have a look at the BWF books where there are different kind of these, but again, just to give you an idea of that we have to be, when we start observing, it's important that we break things down. So we're focusing different times on you know, putting, saying, okay, now we're focusing on technical, now we're focusing on tactical, now we're focusing on, in this case, technical footwork, technical racket skills, technical whatever it could be, but be careful that we don't have it as a, you know, bigger picture and saying, okay, this is, so we're trying to break it down and make it specific as possible. And then, after making use observations, analyzes, then the next thing will be to actually make some kind of a goal setting. In this case, I just put up four things that I see as a value of making some goal settings. Goals help to focus training. Goals help to motivate. Monitor player progress and also kind of for yourself. Monitoring, coaching, effectiveness in terms of making sure you are delivering what you actually put in place.
Can I jump in there?
Yes, of course.
I think this around our planning and especially goal setting, there's one, you know, besides the motivating factor of it, what is another crucial reason and or a good outcome when you sit down with somebody, and maybe one player or whether with your team, when you sit down and plan and goal setting and doing that together, what does it create?
It creates a relationship between the two of you.
Yeah, it creates a relationship, definitely. There's a very important reason or a very important outcome of that, which is very, if you don't do it, if you don't plan and don't do goal setting, yeah, it doesn't create those two things which are crucial to measure up to have a high percentage chance that you're actually going to achieve what you set out.
You mean where you're going?
Ownership.
Commitment.
Yes, the commitment and the accountability. Mm. Because it's not later when you're if you're in a job, you know, and they use KPIs or whatever, without giving a clear indication of what the expectation is, setting goals and planning creates expectation where therefore there is accountability on both sides, both from the coach. It's not just a player, right? It creates a commitment both ways, because if you put down and this is what you want to do, then this is my role as a coach, this is, you know, the player, so it creates a whole accountability commitment thing where for the coach you can go back to the player and say, hey, but you know, you've said that you wanted to do this and such, but you're actually not doing it. But at the same time, the owner is also the coach to make sure that we do everything possible to assist the player with those goals. So just start by that. I add that terminology to it because I think that's important. You have created accountability for basically.
Sure. So yeah, goal setting is and sometimes it can be hard. What kind of goals do we have? We talked a little bit about it yesterday.
Short-term, achievable goals.
Yeah, long-term, short-time, yeah.
Achievable goals.
Yeah.
Outcome-based.
Process goals. Yeah.
Smart goals.
Smart goals, smarter goals, as opposed to that. Next slide, I'd like to tell you, just jump there. So, smarter. So, normally we stop kind of, we have smart goals, but today it's smarter goals. So yeah, we talked about that a little bit yesterday. So the smarter philosophy is, of course, that it has, starting with yes, that it has to be specific, it has to be measurable, it has to be agreed with the players. So as teacher just mentioned here, to create that ownership, that commitment, that drive from the player as well. It has to be realistic. Very, very important as I see it. Talked a little bit about it yesterday as well. I mentioned the thing about it's okay to have the dream goal as well, fluffering out here, but that's something that you as a player keep either for yourself or only for the very, very closest. That's okay. But then you have your real goal, that at least has to be realistic, very realistic. Terms of being able to achieve it. It has to be timed. Can't just say I want to win nationals, but when you want it, or I want to be able to do this. Environment, especially when we're talking, can anyone kind of just give me an idea of what that E environment stands for? Now we're going from smart to smarter. So why is E put in there now? Why is environment put in there?
Because you have to understand your environment, create the environment to actually have this happen.
Yeah, but if you just take this for example, can you read it? It says here by the 24th of April, it should probably say 2017 or 2000, yeah, whatever. April, the player will be able to consistently perform a forehand net shot to within one racket length of the net from a predictable hand feed.
Okay. Yeah.
So that's kind of here is the environment. So where is it that I want to be able to do whatever it is? Is it in a match situation? Is it in a hand feed? Is it against the top 10 players in my country? Is it, when is it? What's the environment that I have to be able to actually hit this shot or be able to do this and this and this? So that's the environment. Record it. Kind of makes sense. We have to write it down. So again, as we talked about, TK mentioned yesterday, we couldn't find that video or that thing about everybody was talking about smart and smarter balls and all that sort of stuff. But this is just one way of looking at or trying to goal setting using smarter.